Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bay Area Chinese Bible Church. We are so glad that you can worship virtually with us today. My name is Alvin Jong. I am the head deacon of our church council, and this is my first time being MC here, so I'm kind of excited. And as an added bonus, my son Ethan will be MC for house worship today. So you get two Jongs in one day. So just a reminder that if you go out and about out of your home, please bring your face covering and maintain social distancing. Wash your hands thoroughly for at least 20 seconds and follow the shelter-in-place guidelines by our local and state governments. If you have any prayer requests or need help, please email info@bacbc.org or one of the pastors. And this morning, I'm pleased to give you some updates on some events that are coming up. And one of the first ones, if you have not noticed, we have a brand new website. Same URL, bacbc.org, but the website is totally revamped with lots of new features, graphics, so please check it out. And I hope you are enjoying the midweek emails that we are sending out to give you updates and encouragement. Stay connected. Another way to contact us is through info@bacbc.org or the church phone numbers. Our church office is technically closed. The church office is actually here in MC1. You can't see it, but there's desks and computers lined up against the wall here where the church staff sits, and you may contact them through the phone number or email address. And if you are ready to be a church member, we have a virtual membership class. It's a four-week class given in three different languages, and we have listed here the three instructors. And if you want to be a member, you must take this class first, and you'll learn more about how to become a member and also learn some church history. So please contact one of these instructors if you're interested. And I am very excited to, for next week, we have a special speaker for our English services. He is Dr. Earl Crawford. He's a pastor from the Praises of Zion Baptist Church in San Leandro. And after the service, at approximately 1:15, he will have a Zoom Q&A session to talk about a conversation on race and the church. There is a RSVP link there that you can click on to sign up, and more details will be coming out in the midweek email and also at the English services next week. But I hope you can attend that special service at 9:30 or 11:15 next week. So that'll be combined for Alameda English and House. And also level 52 for our fourth and fifth graders. October 30th, we'll have a virtual Harvest Fest. So more details, you can register with Amelia, her email and phone number is there. And that will be at 7:30 to 8:30. Wear your favorite t-shirt and come and celebrate with the level 52. Today we'll be showing our baptismal service that we held on September 26th. In case you missed that or you want to watch it again, there is a link in the bulletin that you can click on and you can view the baptismal service from 9:26. And today at 1:30, after the house service, there will be a special middle school Zoom session that you can meet the with the house team. That's for the sixth and eighth graders, sixth through eighth graders. This is the link and the password, and you can encourage your sixth through eighth graders to participate in that today. Today, we will also have communion. So please have your elements ready to participate in communion with your family today. And that will happen after the sermon. And this will take a moment to pray for our tithes and offerings. As you know, although we're not meeting here physically in service on campus, we still have a building, we still have staff, we still have bills to pay. So we definitely need to continue tithing and providing offerings to support this ministry. Myself, I give my tithing through PushPay, and that is very convenient. You may also send your check to the church office, our North Loop address. So at this time, let me take a moment to pray for our offering. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for our church, Berea Chinese Bible Church, and we just thank you for the staff and everyone that supports this, the operations and the church, that we can just minister to the Bay Area. And we just pray for the offering this morning, that we pray for the giver, that they would be able to give cheerfully to support this ministry. And we just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So at this time, let's get ready to sing along with the worship team. That will be Benny and Annette Sue this morning. But thank you.
Kingdom, leaving the paths of sin. oppose me, foes may beset me, still will I enter in. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you here to worship with us at BACBC. It's been a while since I've come to you via this broadcast, and the reason is starting in September, our San Leandro campus went live with our Zoom worships. And so today, San Leandro, I just want to say a special good morning to you as well as you join in the Alameda live broadcast. And you know, today we're going to be looking at Job chapters 22 to 27. It is a huge chunk of scripture. So this morning, as I share with you, I'm going to be summarizing sort of the big ideas of each of the chapters as we come and hone in on this idea of answering the question of why. Why, God, did you allow this to happen to Job? And I think it's appropriate that we are going through the book of Job, especially during this time when I think many of us have that question floating in the back of our minds. Why, God, do we live in this really odd, strange, difficult time? So for those of you who are using a physical Bible, have that turned and marked in Job for chapters 22 to 27. And those of you who are using your phone for your Bible today, you're going to be doing some swiping, all right? So while you get your Bibles ready and set to go, share with you a little bit about my college days, which were a long, long, long time ago. I went to UC Berkeley. I was a psych major. And In all of the different areas of study for psych, my favorite was developmental psychology because it deals with kids, right? And what college student wouldn't want to mess with all the little kids in his family? Just kidding. I was really drawn into one developmental theorist named Piaget, and he is considered the father of child development. And Piaget believed that there were these tasks that children had to accomplish as they were developing and maturing through their years on their way to adulthood. And one of the big metaphors that he presented in his theory was this idea that little children are like scientists, right? So imagine with me this idea of kids going into the world and they've got their little magnifying glass and they live their life and they experience things, and based upon their experience, they draw conclusions. So essentially, Piaget is saying little kids, they explore, they apply the scientific method, and then they come up with a conclusion. And these conclusions that they draw then shape how they live life, right? And I think we can identify with this in our own way as we think about our own childhood, right? So, you know, for me, every time I did my chores or helped my mom wash the dishes or did something correct, right, got good grades, then perhaps I was rewarded with candy or perhaps some allowance money or something like that. And so I developed this idea or this theory in my mind that when I did well, when I did things and that were deemed good, then I would be rewarded. And on the flip side, my little scientist self also learned that when I did things that were not good, when I was doing things that were considered wrong, like disobeying my parents or not getting good grades or forgetting to do my chores, then I was faced with negative consequences, right? Which could include grounding, being stuck in my room, not being able to go out with my friends, et cetera, right? We develop this idea of positive and negative consequences, right? And this kind of way of living works well for the most of our lives, right? When you go to school, if you score well on your exams, then that leads to a positive outcome, right? You get to apply to better colleges, you have the potential of being accepted to better colleges. When you work hard at work, then it leads to perhaps promotions or pay increase, et cetera, right? And when we don't do that, then we find ourselves on the negative end of the stick. And it's easy to carry this one-to-one correlation thinking into our spiritual walk, right? And that's why I think for most of us, when we look into this book of Job, we step away and we think, why, God, this doesn't make sense? Because in the beginning of Job, God, you yourself say that he is a righteous man. So why would you allow all this stuff to befall him? Why would you allow his life to implode and collapse before him? That does not make sense, right? Because when we do well, we should be rewarded. In fact, this idea of a one-to-one positive correlation was even carried by his friends, right? And that's where we open up today in Job chapter 22, when his buddy Eliphaz addresses Job, right? And if we look in verses 1 through 3 in chapter 22, it says this: Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered and said, "Can a man be profitable to God? Surely he who is wise is profitable to himself. Is it any pleasure to the Almighty if you are in the right? Or is it a gain to him if you make your ways blameless?" And what Job's buddy is saying here essentially to him is, Job, first of all, you know, you're defending yourself, you're saying that you haven't done anything wrong, and at the end of the day, Job, does it really matter? Like, is God's life going to be tremendously changed or different because you're somehow, you know, a righteous man as you claim? And he continues on in verses 4 to 11 with this list, this laundry list of sins that Job must have committed in order to have this calamity befall him, right? Because in Eliphaz's mind as well, the things were not adding up. The way Job claimed to live his life, but this reality of this calamity in his life, it doesn't add up. So Job had to have done something wrong. So he's presenting this laundry list of sins. Job, you must have done this. Job, you must have done that. Maybe, Job, you're too embarrassed to admit it to us, but admit it to God. You are wrong. You have sinned. You have grave sin, right? In verse 5, is not your evil abundant? There is no end to your iniquities. Now, can you imagine if you were Job and you're sitting there, and these friends come and they're supposed to be offering you some advice and level of comfort, and instead you have your buddy here sitting telling you that you must have engaged in sins X, Y, and Z. Otherwise, why would this happen? In Eliphaz's mind too, there must be a one-to-one correlation. And he ends in verse 21 by telling Job this: agree with God and be at peace, thereby goodwill will come to you. Oh my goodness, right? Job, just snap out of it, admit you're wrong, and this will go away. Have you ever been accused of something that you haven't done, right? It's infuriating, right? I remember growing up, I had a friend that lived down the street from me. Our grandmothers were good friends. He happens to be an actor named Daniel Wu, very popular in Hong Kong and now popular in American films. He played that Hong Kong scientist, I forget the name of the movie, where the whole world was imploding. Anyway, that's him. So Danny and I, we were often playdates because our grandmothers and our moms were really, really good friends. He lived just down the street. And Danny was just a couple years older than me, and he was the only boy and the youngest kid in his family. And he was very, very spoiled. Danny, forgive me for saying this. But we would play, and then we inevitably would get into fights and arguments. And then, you know, he would, you know, wrestle me. And since I was the chubbier, fatter one, I would just lay on him and crush him. And then he would cry, right? And then his grandmother would come, and he would say, oh, it's Chris's fault. He hurt me. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I was just defending myself, right? And I would just plead to my grandma, no, he's lying. It's not my fault. It's not my fault. I'm innocent. But who was the one that got time out? Yeah, anyway. Being accused of something, falsely accused of something, is completely infuriating, isn't it? And we find Job in that place. And so that leads us to chapter 23, when Job responds to Eliphaz's claim by saying this: no, I have not committed grave sin as you have claimed. In fact, Job is so riled up that he paints this picture that he wishes that he could go into God's celestial courtroom, right, and present his case, argue as a self-appointed attorney for himself, and say, God, this is not right because I am arguing for myself that I am righteous. I have not committed any of these sins that my friends say that I must have committed in order to have this calamity befall me. Lord, look at my record, look at this case, and God, as my judge, you declare me righteous. He wants to do that. Right? He has such a desire to argue his case before God. But the overwhelming, overarching theme we have in chapter 23 is this idea that God is nowhere to be found. In fact, Job is pleading and asking, God, where are you? I want to find you. You are distant. I cannot see you, feel you, in order to come and approach you and present my case so I can declare my innocence. God seems distant, far away, unable to be found. And so again, as we look at this, we can ask ourselves the question, are there moments in our lives too where we feel that we are experiencing something and we don't understand why that negative experience is happening? We can't seem to understand because there is nothing that we've done perhaps to usher in such a consequence. And we're asking and looking to God to help us understand this, and God seems far, right? Perhaps we feel like maybe our prayers are unheard or unanswered, or perhaps God is too busy to pay attention to what's going on in our lives, right? Those feelings of being distant from God. And we think, what did I do to deserve this? When I started seminary many, many years ago at Western Seminary in Portland, Oregon, I remember on the first day of class, I met a new friend. And I'll tell you something funny, right? Because I went to Western in Oregon, Portland, Oregon, and when I stepped onto campus, everybody was very Northwestern. You know, they had the cargo shorts, the wool socks with the Teva sandals, the beard, and the white t-shirt underneath with the plaid shirt jacket thing, right? And here I am, the joyful Californian, in my shorts and, you know, tennis shoes and, you know, looking like someone that came from the beach. In fact, that's what they said to me to make fun of me, right? And so I'm like, I don't fit in. But sitting next to me was this blonde girl who also looked like she came from the beach. And so we started talking, and within 5 minutes, I knew that Cody, she was going to be a friend for life because we just connected. I you know, we refer to each other as the opposite gender self, right? So I'm the male Cody, and she's the female Chris, right? We're that kind of friends. And we've maintained our friendship to this day, and you know, she is just a wonderful woman of God, and God has used her to do so many things to touch and influence the lives of women in the local greater Portland area. And I always think of Cody as this really wonderful, spiritually gifted woman, right? She speaks truth in a marvelous way. Well, if we rewind the timeline 2 or so years back, Cody was pregnant with her then, I think, fifth child. And, you know, she called me to let me know that she was expecting again. We celebrated. I was so excited for her. And a few months later, I received a phone call from her, and she said, "I have some bad news." And I said, "What's going on?" And it was diagnosed that her child in her had what they call trisomy 13. And it's a very rare condition where on the 13th chromosome, there's an irregularity. And it leads to a child being born missing vital organs. And usually what happens is either the child dies in the womb or survives for a few hours after being born. And so, you know, we shared in that sad moment and we cried together over the phone. And, you know, when we hung up, all I could think was, God, why would you allow this to happen in Cody's life? She is a godly woman. She has done so much for you. She is a beautiful person. Why? This is not fair, God. She has nothing that she's done to deserve this, right? And again, it is easy for us to fall into that pattern of thinking that life and our relationship with God and our experience of life is based upon an understanding of a one-to-one correlation. I do well, I do good, therefore God must reward me in life being lived, you know, hunky-dory, warm, fuzzy, and nothing goes wrong. And if I sin, and if I do something gravely bad, then I will then expect to have an equally bad consequence. And this is the question that we are wrestling with. This is the question that Job's friends are presenting. And Job continually, through these chapters again, say that he's done nothing wrong. And again, in chapter 24, Job continues his discourse by looking to God and asking God, why do you allow this to happen, God? Why do you allow this to happen? And he specifically addresses that question, God, why do you allow evildoers to get away with murder? Right? God, they're truly evil people out there. There are truly people who are unrighteous, doing all kinds of unethical and wrong activities in our world. And it seems like they go unpunished. Why, God? Why? And underlying his whole dialogue with God is this understanding. And Lord, here I am, right? Doing nothing remotely similar to these evildoers in the world. And again, my life is imploding. Lord, what is going on, right? In those moments when I hung up the phone with my friend Cody, I similarly had those same thoughts. Lord, what is going on? Why her? Why would you allow this? So we're following along this sort of dialogue where there's Job's friends presenting these ideas. You must be a sinner. You must not only be a sinner, you must be a real bad sinner. And Job then defending himself, saying, no, I've done nothing wrong. I've done nothing wrong. And crying out to God, trying to understand what is happening. Which leads us to chapter 25, where Job's friend Bildad gives this final speech where he concludes this friend meeting by summarizing God's character. It's kind of comical, right? As you look through this progression of events where the whole time spent together, Job's talk with his friends, it's kind of getting nowhere, right? They're presenting all these things. Job's saying, no, you're wrong. They're starting to talk over each other. And imagine, if you will, chapter 25 kind of encompassed with this thought of, like, you know, the friends sitting there going, okay, good talk, right? We're going to bring this to a close. We're going to come to a conclusion. And Bildad, in chapter 25, it says this, verses 1 through 6. Then Bildad the Shuhite answered and said, dominion and fear are with God. He makes peace in his high heaven. Is there any number to his armies? Upon whom does his light not arise? How then can man be in the right before God? How can he who is born of woman be pure? Behold, even the moon is not bright, and the stars are not pure in his eyes. How much less man who is a maggot, and the son of man who is a worm? Essentially, Job's friend here, Bildad, is making this closing argument saying, well, you know, God is great and holy and awesome, and humans, we are like maggots. There you go, Job, my friend, maggot buddy, right? It's funny, right? You know, it's, they're realizing that this conversation is not going anywhere, so he just kind of does this closing speech, if you will. And we can appreciate Bildad's sort of oomph of a statement, right? Capturing some theological truth, right? It is true. God is great. He is above all. He is holy. And humankind, compared to God, we are lower than the low, right? But it's funny because this, again, does not address Job's problem. It does not answer the question that is floating there for all this time, why God would allow this to happen to him, right? To Job, a man who God himself says is righteous. So we now go to chapter 26, where again, Job responds to the message of his friends. And he essentially, in the beginning of chapter 26, flat out says, well, you guys are useless. All that you've said has not helped me, has not encouraged me, probably has done everything to make me more sad and depressed, and does not answer the burning, yearning question in the room. And Job, too, goes on in verses 5 through 14 in chapter 26 to talk about God's character. And we'll read that together, verses 5 through 14 in chapter 26. It says, the dead tremble under the waters and their inhabitants. Sheol is naked before God, and Abaddon has no covering. He stretches out the north over the void and hangs the earth on nothing. He binds up the waters in his thick clouds, and the cloud is not split open under them. He covers the face of the full moon and spreads over it his cloud. He has inscribed a circle on the face of the waters at the boundary between light and darkness. The pillars of heaven tremble and are astounded at his rebuke. By his power, he stilled the sea. By his understanding, he shattered Rahab. By his wind, the heavens were made fair. His hand pierced the fleeting serpent.
Behold, these are but the outskirts of his ways, and how small a whisper do we hear of him, but the thunder of his power, who can understand? Right, Job too agrees, completely agrees in this idea that God is great and he is amazing and he is all powerful and he controls everything and he knows everything, right? And as I look at this, I kind of wonder, like, if Job is even trying to be funny, right? To one up his friend Bildad by saying, well, you want to talk about how cool God is? Here's my version, right? And again, it's not that Job disagrees with this discussion of God's character. All he is saying is, yes, I know this. I understand this. You're preaching to the choir. However, my issue is I'm trying to understand why this is happening to me. So we move to chapter 27, the last chapter in this section that we are talking about today, where Job again defends his integrity. And he paints this, again, asks this pointed question, right? This elephant that has not left the room. And that question that remains is, we're not talking about God's goodness or his character. We are not saying any of that is not true. Indeed, it is true. But the question remains, God, why do you allow evil to happen in this world? God, why do you allow bad things to happen to good people? Now, as we come to the close of chapter 27 in this section of Scripture, that question is unanswered. There is no direct answer as to why. In fact, you know, Job and his friends are at an impasse in their good talk, right? Because Job's friends still believe strongly that Job must have done some really bad things in order for this to happen. And Job is still there saying, I haven't done any really bad things, and I'm wondering why all of this happened, right? And there is no answer. Now think about it for a moment with me. If we were in Job's shoes, we probably feel the same way, right? Because we are accustomed in our lives, again, going back to this theory that Piaget has of us being little scientists, we are accustomed to living life in this framework of a one-to-one correlation, right? We do well, then we should live well. We do poorly, then we live poorly. But here, we are presented with a situation where it is one big question mark. And we are left living in this no man's land of why, right? Why is this happening? And we are searching, and if we were Job, I'm sure we would be searching endlessly for that answer. Perhaps today you are facing some events in your life. You are facing some circumstances in your life. And in your mind, you are thinking, why, God? Why do I deserve this? Why is this happening to me? I have done nothing wrong. I have spent countless hours on my knees praying in confession, wondering and asking you if there's something I've done wrong. And I don't understand why I have to have my life implode and face these circumstances. It is easy for us to move into that framework where we are clawing and digging and asking God, why, answer me now. And perhaps one of the reasons why God decided to include Job in Scripture is to make us just sit in silence and wait. And to make us be in a place where we eat our words and we realize that before God, we truly are humbled. And the point, perhaps, is not demanding an answer or reason for the situation, but just to continue living, trusting, clinging to God for what's next. And that is hard for us to swallow, right? That is hard for us to accept because we as a people by nature want to know and want to know right now. Growing up, I was one of those kids, and you know, God bless my parents for dealing with me, but I could not, would not wait till Christmas Day to open my presents. You know, my parents would lock them in a room and I somehow would break the door open. And so all of my life to this day, I do not wait to Christmas Day to open my presents. I have no patience, right? Delayed gratification, a lesson not learned too well by myself. So I have to open it. I have to rip it open. You know, once the moment I receive it from somebody, oh, that paper comes off and like, wow, this is so cool, right? And I put myself in Job's shoes thinking that I would probably go nuts, right? Having to not know and just wait and be patient. Oh, what is that? Can't handle it. But perhaps in Job, we have this lesson. So there's a few takeaways that I want us to gather from this section of scripture, which quite honestly leaves us feeling with no answers, right? And the first takeaway that I want us to think deeply about is that there may be times where we may not understand why we are experiencing suffering. We may not know why, and we have to be okay with that, because at the end of the day, God knows why, right? We have the luxury of being able to read through the book of Job today and see from end to end, beginning to end, what happens, right? We know at the beginning that there is a celestial event happening where Satan and God are having this discussion about whether or not Job is righteous. This is all unbeknownst to Job, right? And we too can be experiencing this implosion of our lives, and when we can invest all of our energies in trying to figure out why, and we have to be okay with this idea that there may be times where we may not understand, period. But we need to trust and cling to God because He knows. Right? And this is where all that theology that we see Job's friends talking about, and even he himself talking about, that it is true that we are humble and below God, that He is our King, that He knows everything, He is omniscient, He knows the timeline from beginning till end, and we are limited, finite human beings that cannot see or understand the complete big picture. We only see that little aspect of life that we are currently living in real time. And with that, we have to be okay that there will be times and there will be moments where we don't understand. It's like saying, I need to learn to wait till Christmas Day to open all my presents. Don't be like me. Develop patience and faith in God, recognizing that we may not get it, but He does. The second takeaway that I want us to have coming out of these passages is that we shouldn't assume that the goal of obedience equals material blessing, right? We don't obey God. We don't strive to live righteously because an expected end result is blessing. We should not go about our lives thinking, I'm going to please God today because the end result is I'm going to have a pleasing life. Now, there are many, many instances, and we have to admit that we are showered with blessings by God. We are so blessed. But at the end of the day, the bigger picture is not this one-to-one way of living. We don't obey God because we expect to have good things happen in our lives. We obey God because we love Him. We obey God and we strive to live righteously because it glorifies Him. We obey Him and we live in a right way because it showcases to the rest of the world our faith in our God. That's the point, right? God's glorification, that people will look and see this way you're living, question, ask why, and the answer left is because we believe in this wonderful, amazing, great God. We don't do this out of an expectation that our life is somehow going to be more livable, it's going to be better, it's going to have more material wealth. No, we obey because we love God. The third thing that I want us to gain from here is that there are times and seasons in life where we have to be comfortable and get comfortable with this idea of silence, where God may not answer you immediately, and you must sit in silence. At Western, I got 2 degrees. One was in pastoral ministry. The second was in counseling. And I remember when it got to that point where I had to start my counseling internships, my professor would then review with me videotapes of counseling sessions that I did. And one of the big feedbacks that I received continuously from my supervisor and my professor was, you need to be silent. Right? Because I would ask a question and then my client wouldn't answer. And then I would feel uncomfortable, right? Because you can see in the video, which is showing my back and my hands are all twisting and turning, and I have this look of like, I don't know what to do, it's silent, oh no, right? And my professor told me, silence is a beautiful thing because it means that your client is thinking and they're trying to answer your question and they may need a moment to synthesize their ideas. Silence is beautiful. Because as you, being a therapist, not saying anything, you force your client then to respond to you. So there is growth there. Don't discount silence. And that you know, has stuck with me ever since those critiques and those evaluations of my counseling sessions done as an intern. That we as a people, we don't like silence, right? We like to fill in the gap, right? That's why we walk around with our earbuds in our ear all the time. We like to fill the silence. Silence is uncomfortable, but I would venture to say that when we encounter moments of silence with God, it is a time for us to learn to be quiet, to wait attentively, to ponder, to think, and just be quiet. And to learn to live in that silence and to see what God can show us and teach us and how he can grow us in those moments of silence. And lastly, I would say that it is important for us to trust in God's overall plan, because God sees the big picture and we can only see what's in front of us. And we may not understand what's happening in the bigger celestial realms. We may not understand why we're experiencing what we're experiencing until many, many, many months or years later, when we can look back and we say, I can see it. God was doing something during that time. Trust in him. Trust in his timing. Trust in his sovereignty. Trust in his promise to us that he is our God, that he has redeemed us, and he will not turn his back on us. We have nothing to fear. Yes, it is uncomfortable sometimes. Yes, we do experience physical suffering. And yes, nothing may seem perfect in those times. Hard times. But it is an exercise for us to force ourselves to open our hearts, our minds, every part of us, and to cling on the truths we know about God in the Bible, and to have faith to know that his plan is the best. And yeah, we may not understand. And yes, of course, it may not necessarily feel good in the moment. And yes, God may be silent, but at the end of the day, he is God, and we are his children. And so we wait in anticipation, looking to our God for him to guide and lead us, even though in the current moment we may feel confused and we may not understand. at the end of the day, you know, it sounds cliche, but we can capture this with this simple understanding that God is God and we're not, right? And I say that a lot, but it is a truth that is difficult for us to stomach and fully embrace and understand sometimes, because we, you know, we as human creatures, we just need to know why. And today I say from these chapters in Job, there may be times where why isn't answered, but that doesn't mean that God's not there. And it doesn't mean that he doesn't care. And it doesn't mean that he's forgotten about you. There may be times when we need to put on our big boy pants and our big girl pants and walk through these times of silence and quietness and have a heart and attitude of anticipating God and waiting on him to show us what's next in our lives. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can come today, that we delve into these chapters of Job, recognizing, Lord, it is difficult. It's hard to wrestle with what's going on here. And perhaps as we even read through and go through this, Lord, we think to ourselves, oh, why does Job have to have this happen to him? And perhaps for those of us who are in the midst of a struggle, where it feels like our lives are falling apart, we too wonder, God, what is going on? What is happening? Will you give us an answer? But Lord, I pray that you would remind us that you are in control of all things, that you see the entire timeline of life, that you understand, that you have your will, that you have your purpose, you have your ways. So I pray, Lord, for each and every one of us that we may have a heart of faith, a desire to trust, a willingness to let go of control and to look to you and embrace those moments where it is quiet. That we may be a people that wait in anticipation for you to speak to us, that the main point of our relationship with you is not necessarily always understanding the answer to why. We thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign, you are great, you are above all things, and Lord, that you love us, that you've chosen to create us and give us this opportunity to have a relationship with you. And Lord, I just want to honor and raise up to you everyone this morning who is perhaps wrestling with difficult times or a difficult situation in their life. Lord, would you allow them to know that you are with them? Lord, when they may feel that they are far away from you or your presence is not near them, Lord, I pray that you would use your word to remind them that you, God, are always there. Would you comfort them, bring them encouragement, and lift them up? We thank you, Lord, that we can gather today to worship you, our God and our King. And we pray this in our Savior, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. We're going to respond today by coming to communion. And I'm going to read to you out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Starting in verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." It is a befitting reminder this morning, especially as we talk about this idea of struggling with sometimes when we feel God is silent, to know that in Scripture we have the truth laid clearly and plainly for us, that we are a people that have been given a second chance by our God, that his love is unending, and that he proves and shows his love by sending his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to live in this world, to die on the cross, a painful death, to shed his blood and to have his body broken in order for us to be redeemed and saved from our sins so that we can even be in the presence of God. That is the hope we have. That is the truth we have. That is what allows us to remember that no matter what we are going through, that we are a people who are saved and redeemed by the blood of Christ. So as you reflect on that, I'm going to just give you a couple minutes to pray on your own, to perhaps do business with God or whatever he brings to your conscience. And as after a couple minutes of prayer, I'll close us and we'll take the elements together. This time is yours. Our God, we thank you and we give you praise because you are a God who loves us. You're a God who has redeemed us. You're a God who has chosen to give us new life. And so I pray, Lord, as we come together and join our hearts this morning in taking of communion, that it would not be this rote activity that we do once a month. That it would not be something that we feel that we do out of obligation. That it's not something we do because we know perhaps in our minds that it is right to do so. But we do this from a heart of remembrance, understanding, Lord, that we have been given the greatest gift. That our Savior Jesus Christ, his body was broken, his blood was shed, so that we would have the opportunity to receive new life. That the payment for our sins would be paid forever, once and for all. And Lord, that we would be restored to fellowship with God and be able to commune with him once again. Lord, help us to see that that fact is the catalyst to keep us on the path, to keep us moving forward, to give us encouragement when we're down, to give us reason to celebrate and rejoice. Because we are bought at a price, forgiven and set free. That is our hope that we cling to and we grab onto in good times and bad. We thank you, God, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. For those of you at home, I would ask that you grab your elements so that we can prepare and take together. And again, on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and broke it. And he told his disciples that this was representative of his broken body for us. Let us take this together with hearts of thanksgiving, understanding that Jesus, he did this for us. Let's eat together. And in the same way, Jesus took the cup, and as he asked his disciples to take the cup, he reminded them that this cup would be representative of his blood. And so to us, we reflect on the blood shed for us so that we can be redeemed. Let's take together. Will you pray with me? Lord, again, we thank you for your love. We thank you for Jesus and his death on the cross for us. And today, as we join our hearts together, we do this in remembrance of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We do this recognizing the great price he paid. We do this recognizing the great hope that we have received. We give you thanks. And Lord, we ask that you would watch over all of us this upcoming week, or that we would experience your blessings and your presence in ways that are deep and meaningful that we may not have before. And Lord, that you remind us that it is in those moments of silence where we have the opportunity to seek you and to wait on you. We thank you, Lord, and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're not quite done yet. We're going to be watching the video that captures the baptism that happened a couple weeks ago, and join in that. And then after that, we'll have a closing worship. I wish you a very pleasant week. It's wonderful to see all of you, and may God bless you.
Good afternoon, Bay Area Chinese Bible Church. It's Pastor Toby reporting to you guys live outside of MC2. Today we have our first baptismal service since we started this whole quarantine thing. And so we're so glad that you guys can join us live right now. We have two baptismal candidates today, Thomas and Horace. And they're both in elementary school. And they're going to be baptized, but not by me. They're going to be baptized by their parents so that we can remain socially distant. All right? I will be reading their testimonies in just a little bit. But before I get into that, let me explain to you guys what baptism is and why we do it. Baptism is just an outward showing of inward reality. It's a public announcement that these students and these baptismal candidates are already saved. Being baptized doesn't make one saved, but it just shows that they want to publicly declare that they believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. And so all baptism is a public showing of that, all right? It shows that they believe in Jesus Christ and his death and his resurrection. They believe that they are now dead to themselves and now alive in Christ. We've been given a great commission, which is to make disciples and baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And today we get to participate in that. And so before we get into that, let me go ahead and open our time in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you so much for today, for giving us a chance to have this baptismal service, Lord. I know it's been a long time coming, but I'm so glad we get to finally have one. Thank you so much for these two students, Horace and Thomas, and for their professed faith in you. I pray that we'll continue to support them and love them and mature them and grow them and disciple them in your name. Thank you for this time, Lord. I pray all this in your son's name. Amen. Thomas's testimony says this. He's in fourth grade, but he said this. When I was in first grade in 2016, one of my classmates asked the teacher if God was real. So my teacher said, God is real. And if you believe in him and confess your sins, he will forgive you and you will be saved. At that time, I believed that God was real. I continued to come to church with my parents. Well, last year, my mom gave me a Christmas gift 2 weeks in advance, before Christmas. I was so excited that I couldn't wait to open it. I begged my mom if I could open it, and she always said no. I knew if I kept on begging, my mom would never give it to me until Christmas. So I prayed to God that my mom would give me permission to open the gift. Well, God knows my faith in him, and suddenly, my mom gave me permission to open the gift, and that gift was a watch. I knew there is a God and that God is real. He answered my prayers. Well, on September 6th and 13th of this year, I attended two baptism classes. Mrs. Amelia's son shared with me the good news. I realized that I have not accepted Jesus into my heart. So she led a prayer with me and affirmed me that I became a child of God by asking Jesus to forgive my sin and be with me forever. From now on, I will pray to God, read God's word, and obey his word. I am proud that my parents believe in Jesus too. Today, I want to get baptized because I am a believer. I want to follow Jesus' example. Go ahead and step down. Oh. And face the camera. Face the camera. And then, there you go. You swap. There you go. Okay. Thomas, stand. Come more towards me. Good. Okay. Put your left hand on top of his forearm. And go ahead and baptize. All the way down. All the way down. All the way down. Yay. There you go. Yeah, Thomas. Yeah. Look at the camera over here. Smile. Wait, Thomas, don't move. Look at the camera right here.
Smile. Good job.
Yeah. Awesome. All right, you guys can go ahead and go out. As Thomas is exiting, his friend Horace, who they've been bubbling with together, Horace is a third grader, and he's going to be the next one to be baptized, and his mom, who's also a believer, is going to baptize him. Horace says this in his testimony: I know Jesus because my mom shared with me who is Jesus, and my CCS teachers also shared the gospel to me when I was in kindergarten in 2017. I believe in Jesus. He is the Son of God. God loves us, and God gave us his only begotten Son, Jesus. Oh, you guys can go ahead. He was free from sin and died on the cross for us. Also, when I encounter difficulties, God helps me. I accepted Jesus when I was 5 years old. I attend Sunday school regularly. I attended the baptism class on September 6th and September 13th. My baptism class teacher prayed with me and affirmed me that I have Jesus in my heart and that he will forgive my sins. I'm sure that when I die, I will go to heaven. I want to get baptized because I believe in God and I trust in him. I want to let people know that I have faith in him and that I belong to him. So Horace, may you be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit right now. Go ahead and step down into the middle. There you go. And pinch your nose. And go down. All the way down. Awesome. All right, look at the camera. Look at the camera here. Step back a little bit. Wait. Oh, sorry. Or that works too.
Good job.
Oh, one more. Go back, Horace. There you go, both in the sun. All right, Bay Area Chinese Bible Church. That was exciting, wasn't it? I want to thank you guys for being a part of the baptismal service, and hopefully we'll be able to baptize more people soon. Let's close this time in prayer. Heavenly Father God, thank you so much for Thomas and Horace and their confession of faith in you. I pray that you'll continue to grow these boys into men of God who want to pursue you and love you with all of their heart. Thank you for this time, Lord. I pray all this in your son's name. Amen. Love you guys. Peace out. Good job, guys.
No, none to men, for out
knowledge of his infinite riches in Jesus. He giveth and giveth and giveth again. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed, and the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's forgiving is only begun. His love has no limit, his grace has no measure, his power has no boundary, known unto men. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again.